Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Iyad. I am back again to speak about the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ in a series where we want to learn about them. We want to know how they lived, how we can love them through knowledge so we can be with them في الآخرة, inshallah. We're going to be talking about someone very special today, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Asadullah wa Rasuluh. Now, as I said, I'm going to give a very, very small introduction to why we do the series. We do it because if we understand them, if we know about them, we will love them. And if we love them, we will be with them, inshallah. Now, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib was someone very special. We all know the story of how he passed away, how he was killed, actually, in battle. But we're going to dive a little bit deeper into his life, how he lived, and how important he was to Islam. Just to let you know about the importance of Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, radiallahu anhu arda, the Prophet ﷺ says, scholars later on say that if he had lived, he would have been one of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. So we're talking about someone at the level of Sayyidina Umar, at the level of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, at the level of Sayyidina Ali, someone who's very, very important and knowledgeable in Islam, someone who played a big part in the formation of Islam early on. We'll start by talking about just his physical strength, because he was known to be an incredibly strong person. What did he look like? He was someone who was tall. He was someone who was wide. He was someone who was so incredibly strong that he went and hunted in the desert most of the time. He spent most of the time hunting lions. He spent most of the time hunting animals that were exotic, animals that other people did not tend to hunt, that were out of the ordinary, ostriches, for example. And his name, Hamza, means lion. But it doesn't just mean any type of lion. It means the lion that is in a state of hunting, that has already caught its prey and is already ripping into it. So the name itself describes a certain amount of strength, and it perfectly describes the strength of Hamza radiallahu anhu. So like we said, he was tall, he was strong, he was a hunter, and his lineage, he was from Banu Hashim. He was the paternal uncle of the Prophet ﷺ. And some narrations say that his parents and the Prophet's parents actually got married at the same time. So narrations say that he was either very close in age to the Prophet ﷺ, or they were actually about the same age. So they were very close, they were more like brothers, and they were actually fed from the same mother, they were breastfed from the same woman. So they're all also ikhwa fi rida'a. So they're not just, it's not just his uncle, they're not only just close in age, but they're also ikhwa fi rida'a. So a lot of people ask the question of why did Hamza radiallahu anhu not accept Islam early on? There are a lot of narrations about this, there are a lot of sort of things that scholars have said, but generally Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib radiallahu anhu arda, he was someone who was a little bit displaced from Quraysh. He wasn't a merchant. He didn't do the same things that people did. His passion, as you might say, was hunting. He really enjoyed hunting. He really enjoyed staying out in the desert. So he would spend most of his time in the desert hunting and doing the physical activity that he enjoyed doing. And he wasn't really much around. So even if you look at the narrations in the Sirah early on, he wasn't around. You don't see his name pop up a lot when the Prophet ﷺ talks to the people in Mecca about Islam when he لما بيدعو to Islam. So there's the famous incident of how he actually became Muslim. We all know that Abu Jahl was a sworn enemy of Islam, a sworn enemy of the Prophet ﷺ due to tribal reasons, because if a prophet comes from the tribe Banu Hashim, what can we bring forward? So he really hated the Prophet ﷺ, even though he listened to the Quran, even though he knew deep in his heart it was the truth. So Abu Jahl starts abusing and killing the weak Muslims, and then slowly he starts verbally abusing the Prophet ﷺ. And then he gets to the point where he's close to the physical abuse of the Prophet. And there's a narration of one time Abu Jahl holding a large rock and going to the Kaaba and saying that he swears that he's going to crush the blessed head of the Prophet ﷺ. But then he stops because he sees a trench of fire and angels that would kill him if he tries to even touch the Prophet ﷺ. So in one particular incident, he particularly cursed him in a very bad way. He cursed him and he used a curse that used the family name and cursed him by his family and so on. So it was particularly nasty, and no one from the Prophet's tribe was around him to protect him or fend off Abu Jahl. And the Prophet, by his nobility, he didn't respond. He didn't say anything. So subhanAllah, Hamza, radiallahu anhu, he's out hunting in the desert. He comes back And usually when he'd come back, he would have these exotic animals with him. He would disperse the meats, he would share the pelts, and kids in general would swarm around him. You know, they want to see this very cool, interesting person who hunts exotic animals. And then he would go back, sit around the Kaaba, sit in the majalis, sit in the areas where the leaders of Quraysh were sitting. So in this particular incident, after he cursed the Prophet ﷺ, a servant comes up to him, and she tells him, "Do you know what Abu Jahl did to your nephew?" She tells him he sabbu with this, this, and this, and he says, "Awa qad fa'al." And then the narration say that Hamza radiallahu anhu, his face got so red with anger, his body was literally sweating from anger. He walks to Abu Jahl, and he just came back from hunting. So imagine this massive dude with a large bow walking up to Abu Jahl. He walks to Abu Jahl, and then he punches them straight in the face with the bow in his hand. He punches him to the point where Abu Jahl starts bleeding right here. He just cracks his head open. And let it be said that Abu Jahl was also a pretty massive person. He was a huge dude. He was the size of Umar radiallahu anhu. So if it was any smaller man, the person would have died at that punch. Then he says, "You dare curse Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, and I am on his religion, wa ana ala dini," in the moment of anger. And of course, Abu Jahl could have escalated the situation, but he calmed things down because he knew if he kept if he made Hamza radiallahu anhu angrier, Hamza would be on the deen of Islam, because he knew Hamza was not Muslim at the time. So subhanAllah, Hamza radiallahu anhu goes back home at the end of the day, and he did not sleep that night. He did not get one moment of sleep. He was trying to reflect, did I really just become Muslim? So even though he wasn't Muslim, even though there were many idols at that time, he just asked Allah to put peace in his heart towards what was right. And he woke up the next morning, he went to the Prophet ﷺ, and he basically said, "Ashhadu annaka sadiq, fa'adhhar dinaka ibn akhi." Iman settled in his heart, subhanAllah. "Ashhadu annaka sadiq, I believe that you are truthful, Muhammad. Fa'adhhar dinak," let's announce the religion of Islam to the world. And subhanAllah, this was a very big turning point in Islam, because Hamza would become a regular Dar Arqam ibn Abil Arqam, the gatherings of knowledge. And remember, Islam, people were prosecuted early on, and he would be their protector. If there was a noise outside, if someone came around the house trying to figure out what Muslims were doing, Hamza was always ready with his bow or sword to protect the early Muslims in Dar Arqam ibn Abil Arqam. So then comes the Hijrah. We know from the stories and the narrations that all of the Sahaba, even including the Prophet ﷺ, they planned ways to sneak away at night, or found ways to sneak away when Quraysh couldn't catch him. But Hamza radiallahu anhu arda, he goes to the middle of Kaaba, he goes in front of Quraysh and announces that he's leaving, announces that he's going away. And if anyone else wants to duel him, if anyone wants to fight him, I'm right here, you can come get me. So this just kind of shows his courage. That he didn't fear anyone, and no one dared to confront him. No one even tried to crowd him and fight him. They just let him be. They just let him go to Al-Madinah. So it's known that Hamza radiallahu anhu was one of the closest advisors to the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet radiallahu anhu had 14 advisors, and Hamza radiallahu anhu was one of them. And before the Battle of Badr, which we know as one of the first battles in Islam, there were actually two other small scrimmages, where basically Quraysh had already confiscated all the wealth of Muslims, so Muslims wanted to retaliate and get some of their wealth back. So they would do some raids on the caravans that are going from Quraysh to Al-Sham, to Damascus and that area. So in the first, both raids, Hamza radiallahu anhu, he led them, he held Rayat al-Islam, and he was the general in both raids. In the first raid, of course, as they were attacking a caravan, there were 30 people. They were attacking a caravan of 300 people, where Abu Jahl was one of them. And one of the Bedouin leaders who lives in the area made sulh between them, and out of respect for him, Hamza did not attack the tribe, and they went back home. And then in the second time, the Prophet ﷺ joined them in this battle. But again, Hamza was the general. And then we get to the Battle of Badr. So one of the things that a lot of people don't know is that Hamza killed the first person in Badr. He was a man of the name Aswad ibn Abd al-Asad, and he was incredibly, incredibly arrogant. In the Battle of Badr, as we know, Muslims were outnumbered, and they had surrounded all the wells in Badr as a technique in war. So this arrogant man said he will march straight through the Muslims and steal the water, damage their walls, and kill whoever comes up against him. Subhanallah, he tried to march through straight through the ranks of the Muslims. Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib just literally hit him and killed him and sent him back to the kuffar. So the first mushrik that was killed was at the hands of Hamza radiallahu anhu. And then at the beginning of the battle, of course, back then there was the culture of dueling before the battle, where the most worthy opponents would come from each side, side of the war, and they would fight each other, and that would start the war. So Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib was one of the first people who went up, and he dueled with Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, and he killed him. And even before the Battle of Badr, he put an ostrich feather on his chest. You know, when you're fighting in war, you want to be inconspicuous. You don't want people to see who you are or where you're coming from. But Hamza would put this mark on his chest to let people know that I'm here, come get me. I'm very visible. This is where I am. Come get me if you can. So he was that brave, subhanAllah. So he kills Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, and he kills many of the mushrikeen in Badr. And Allah, of course, through the Nasr of Allah, the Muslimin win Badr, and then we go to Uhud. Now, between Badr and Uhud, we got to recall that all of the heads of the mushrikeen, or a lot of the heads of the mushrikeen, were killed in that battle. And in Quraysh, they didn't have the concept of Akhirah, the life that they lived in this worldly dunya, and their pride was all they had. So seeing that their leaders, many of their leaders were killed in Badr, made them fuming with anger. Women were writing poetry of anger and vengeance. People wanted to get vengeance on all the Sahaba and all the people who killed their leaders. And one of those was Hind bint Utbah, where she would recite poetry in vengeance of killing Hamza, and she would dream of mutilating his body. So before the Battle of Uhud, she actually went and got a slave. His name was Wahshi ibn Harb. And he was freed on the premises that he would go to Uhud and he would kill several of the Muslimin. And she specifically pointed him to Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib. So Sayyidina Hamza was in Uhud, fighting with the Muslims. He actually, narration said that he killed 2/3 of the mushrikeen there that were killed. So before he died, he actually killed about 31 people. That's just one man killing 31 people. And something else that we should know about Hamza is that he was so powerful that he could fight with 2 swords. So he was also he was a great warrior. Now, if you think about their swords, they're incredibly heavy. They're not the kind of swords that you can carry in your hands, right? If you try to carry one right now, it'd be too heavy for you. Now imagine he had 2 of those swords and he fought with them. So the narration of Wahshi, of how he killed Hamza radiallahu anh, is that he saw him roaring like a lion in the battlefield, fighting and killing mushrikeen, and then he hid behind a boulder as he watched Hamza radiallahu anh fight. And then after Hamza killed a particular mushrik, his armor was lifted just a little bit above his abdomen, and Wahshi could see a little opening there. And that's when he targeted his spear. He threw it, launched it. It went straight through Hamza radiallahu anh. And Wahshi says that Hamza subhanAllah was so powerful that he actually turned around with a spear in his body and started to chase Wahshi until he actually succumbed to the pain and passed away and died radiallahu anh. And then after that, unfortunately, that wasn't it. Hind bint Utbah came and started mutilating his body. She cut out his liver. She ate parts of it as vengeance for her father and her brother, who was also killed in Uhud, And then the body was incredibly mutilated that you can almost not recognize who he is. And then after the fighting subsided, the Prophet, when he saw Hamza radiallahu anh, he wept in a way that that no one ever saw him weep before, nor before his death, nor after the death of Hamza. Hamza was so close to the Prophet ﷺ. Like we said, he was his brother in the Rula'ah. He was close to him in age. He was his paternal uncle. He was the first powerful Muslim, powerful person to join Islam. So all these factors, and he was also one of the closest advisors to the Prophet, one of his first generals. And if he had lived on, he would have been one of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. So someone incredibly close to the Prophet ﷺ. A powerful moment. It was a terrifying moment. It was an incredibly, incredibly sad scene to see our beloved Prophet ﷺ weep like he weeped for Hamza. And he said these words, "Rahimakallahu ya amma, kunta wasulan lil-rahim, fa'ulan lil-khayrat, Oh, may Allah have mercy on you, my uncle. كنت وصولا الرحم. You were someone who always reached out to family and kept us connected. And وصولا here, and using وصولا here, it means not just you did it, you overdid it. You were always doing it. And تعاون الخيرات, you always did خير, you always did good. It's not like you just did it, you were always continuously in a state of doing it. So this is the life of Hamza radiallahu an. Well, we could go and dive deeper into Wahshi, but we can say that to summarize Wahshi, he became Muslim later on and he killed one of the most evil people at the time, Musaylim al-Kadhab, and then he says, قتلت خير الناس, I killed the best of people, and then I killed the worst of people. With the same spear that he killed Hamza radiallahu an, he killed Musaylim al-Kadhab, who was responsible for the killing and death of many, many Hufad al-Quran. And may Allah have mercy on Hamza radiallahu an, and may Allah unite us with these beautiful people. Jazakumullah khair for tuning in, and inshallah next time we'll have another sahabi that we can dive deeper into their life, so we can love them, so we can be with them, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, dear respected brothers and sisters. Welcome everyone, and welcome again to another episode of How Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just a quick reminder about what we did in the past episodes and what this program is about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us, and He wanted every single one of us to have a personal project in which they become the person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants them to become. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also requested us to change them to become in the state and the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires. And this program is about how to do that, is about a way to break down that problem, a way to go step by step towards solving this problem. So just quickly, in the past two episodes, two episodes, we talked about, first of all, the importance of having a plan and how the Prophet did have a vision, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requests us of having a vision and understanding what we're doing. In the second one, we talked about the importance of the preacher, the person. If you're fixing somebody, you having credibility in the eyes of the person that you're fixing, and how the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, spent 40 years amongst his people until they trusted him, until they understood that this person, what he says, matches what he does. And that's what a preacher, a person who is responsible for fixing somebody and for taking somebody to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has to build. This credibility has to be built before that person starts accepting the truth. I felt that I didn't do this point its justice last time, and that's why I'm giving a second part to it. And in this part, we're going to talk about fixing ourselves. So in the last episode, we talked about fixing the credibility in people's eyes. Now we want to fix ourselves. In this episode, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to talk about fixing ourselves to be ready to the second step. The step we're going to start exploring the ayat and the evidence of the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the ayat and the evidence of the prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in this step, we have to prepare ourselves to accept the truth. And again, the truth that Islam is a truthful religion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a prophet from him. So why do we even have to prepare ourselves to accept the truth? Why don't we just present the truth as it is to ourselves or to the people that we're preaching before fixing them or before preparing them, and just put it as it is and let them accept it or reject it? That's not the proper way of doing it. Why? Because the reality is that people can see the truth and still reject it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had explained to us a lot of different attributes that would lead to such an act, that would lead to the rejection of the truth. Even if you present it so clearly, so precisely, So honestly, with all the evidence, with all the explanation, it would still be rejected. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps us and explains to us some of the attributes that are very detrimental and very critical and could lead to such an act of rejection of the truth. And our job is to make sure that we fix these attributes in ourselves and in the people that we are trying to fix or we're trying to preach so that they would accept the truth. First of all, liars, lying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَفْتَرِي الْكَذِبَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ إِنَّمَا يَفْتَرِي الْكَذِبَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَذِبُونَ. The translation of this ayah says, only they invent falsehood who don't believe in the signs of Allah, and only they are the liars. So the first attribute we have to be looking after and be very careful of is lying. So if I notice that my kid, my student, is a person who frequently lies, that's a bad sign. That's a sign that this could be an attribute that would take them accepting and instilling the iman in their heart. The second ayah that we have here that includes a couple of attributes is وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. And they rejected those signs unjustly and arrogantly, though their souls were convinced thereof. So see what was the end of those who acted corruptly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us of two bad attributes. Unjust, being unjust, and being arrogant. The third ayah that we have in our hands is انظر كيف كذبوا على أنفسهم وضل عنهم ما كانوا يفترون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us of lying to ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be honest with ourselves. For those who are not honest with themselves, that attribute could lead them to the rejection of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the truth of Islam. So the message that I have for you as a da'iyah, as a preacher, as a murabbi, as a person who's trying to fix others, look and try to diagnose those that you're preaching. Look and try to diagnose yourself. Be honest, be critical. It's a matter of trying to fix ourselves for the akhirah. It's a critical thing that requires honesty. So when we are trying to diagnose ourselves to see these attributes, if we have them or not, we have to be honest, we have to be critical, and we have to understand the significance of that. And fixing ourselves, to take ourselves away from these attributes, from lying, from being unjust, from being arrogant, as all of these attributes could lead to the rejection of the truth. So, and another thing that I want to signify here is, it's not clear cut. It's not like you should be known to be a liar to reject the truth. The thing that I want to deliver here is that the more honest, the more just, and the more humble we are, the more ability we will have to accept the truth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more we get rid of these amrad of qulub, these diseases of heart, the more our hearts will be ready to accept the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَى سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَى أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وباليوم الآخر وما هم بمؤمنين يخادعون الله والذين آمنوا وما يخدعون إلا أنفسهم وما يشعرون في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا. So the reason why people don't accept the truth is amrad of qulub. Get rid of these amrad to purify ourselves, to instill these good traits, being honest, being just, and being humble, to be able to accept the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll drive some more confidence into this by bringing a couple of more evidence, pieces of evidence. The first of which is of a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I've mentioned this hadith in the past episode, but I'm going to mention it again because it works perfectly with the message. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "عليكم بالصدق فإن الصدق يهدي إلى البر وإن البر يهدي إلى الجنة، وما يزال الرجل يصدق ويتحرى الصدق حتى يكتب عند الله صديقا. وإياكم والكذب، فإن الكذب يهدي إلى الفجور، وإن الفجور يهدي إلى النار، وما يزال العبد يكذب ويتحرى الكذب حتى يكتب عند الله كذابا. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم tells us that the attribute of صدق is the one that leads to birr, is the one that leads to good deeds. And the attribute of following in false, and the attribute of uttering falsehood, of being a liar, is the attribute that leads to fujur, to wickedness. Another saying that we can deliver here is يروي الإمام أحمد في مسنده بسند صحيح أن أبا بكر رضي الله عنه قال يا أيها الناس إياكم والكذب فإن الكذب مجانب للإيمان. أبو بكر رضي الله عنه, the one who was the closest friend to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the closest companion to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the one who saw the transformation of people from باطل to حق, the one who saw the transformation of people from darkness to light, the one who had so much understanding of this religion, the one who really understood who were able to go and convert to this religion and those who are not able to, he tells us about the attribute that makes us accept this religion and makes us increase in iman. And he warns us about kadhib. He warns us about lying. And the first type of lying that we have to be careful of is lying to ourselves. So we have to step back, and we have to step back and look at ourselves. Look at our actions. Look at what we do on a daily basis. Look at in our interactions with people and try to see how can we be more honest with ourselves. And inshallah ta'ala, this act, if it becomes a habit, if it becomes a habit, Allah, with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, honesty will be instilled as an attribute in ourselves. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, that when we want to instill a habit, or we want to instill an attribute in ourselves, we have to work on it. I'm trying to remember the hadith here. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Innama al-ilmu bit-ta'allum wa innama al-hilmu bit-tahallum." Al-hilm is an attribute. You do it and you acquire it. The Prophet ﷺ is telling us is you acquire it when you seek it, when you look for it, when you work to get it. So honesty, justice, and humility are attributes that we have to work on, and we have to instill ourselves and instill in people that we're preaching in order for them to open their hearts to the truth. And inshallah ta'ala, in the next step, we're going to talk about that truth. We're going to talk about the proof and the evidence that this heart will start accepting inshallah ta'ala and start looking at, to feel and to believe in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to feel and to believe in the prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه من كل ذنب فيا فوز المستغفرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from me and from you and to make us of those who worship him as if we see him. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أن يرينا الحق حقا ويرزقنا اتباعه وأن يرينا الباطل باطلا ويرزقنا اجتنابه. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. See you in next episode. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, وأهلا بكم معنا في وجبة فكر جديدة نبحث فيها فلسفة السلطة عند ميشيل فوكو. ميشيل أو ميشال فوكو هو فيلسوف فرنسي مشهور رحل في الثمانينات, وهو من أبرز رواد فلسفة ما بعد الحداثة. ما بعد الحداثة هي تيار عام للفلسفة جاء بعد منتصف القرن العشرين تقريبا, ولو أنه ممكن نقول أنه بداياته كانت في بدايات القرن العشرين مع نيتشه, وهي قائمة أساسا على نبذ الحقائق والفلسفات والتيارات والقصص والسرديات الكبرى. يعني جاءت لنقد الحقائق ونقد حتى الوصول إلى المعرفة في بعض تياراتها السفسطائية المتطرفة. والفيلسوف الفرنسي كان من رواد هذا التيار, بما أنه من الشائع أن بعض الفلاسفة الكبار كانوا مهتمين بقضية واحدة يركزون فيها مشاريعهم الفكرية. مثلا ماركس كان مهتم بالاقتصاد وصراع الطبقات, نيتشه كان مهتم بفلسفة القوة، كانت بنقد العقل، وديكارت أيضا قبله بالعقل، مونتسكيو بالحرية إلى آخره. فلدينا فوكو ارتبط اسمه بالسلطة، بتحليل السلطة، بما أنه كما قلنا فوكو من رواد ما بعد الحداثة، فكرته وفلسفته وأفكاره بشكل عام قائمة على فكرة أنه ما في حقائق مطلقة، والمعرفة بشكل عام مرتبطة بالحاضر والسياق الذي نعيش فيه، فيعني ما في هناك مسلمات وأفكار مجردة. طبعا هذا مبدأ خطير جدا في الفكر، تحديدا عندما بعد الحداثة، وطبعا من أهم نتائجه الإلحاد نفسه، إنكار الحقيقة الكبرى والمطلقة وهي وجود الله تعالى. وفوكو مثل الكثير من رواد ما بعد الحداثة كانوا مهتمين بالخطاب، بالفلسفة اللغوية، ولو أنه ما كان مغرق في هذا مثل الكثير من معاصريه، لكن أيضا هو مثلهم كان يجرد النص عن قائله أو عن مصدره. فالنص، أي نص، سواء كان مقدسا، وهؤلاء طبعا ما عندهم مقدسة لأي شيء، أو أي نص آخر، كل نصوص يمكن أن تفهمها بشكل مجرد عن قائلها، عن نية قائلها ومقصده، يعني تأويل أي نص منفتح على عدد لا نهائي من القراءات. طبعا هذا نجد أثره لدى الكثير من المفسرين الما بعد حداثيين إن صحت التسمية لدينا نحن المسلمين، الذين حاولوا يطعنوا في القرآن الكريم. بعدما بدأ فوكو يدرس السلطة من خلال فلسفة ما بعد الحداثة، بدأ ينقد الكثير من التيارات السابقة له. مثلا الفيلسوف هوبس كان من رواد فلسفة العقد الاجتماعي، هو كان يبرر وجود السلطة أو الحكومة بشكل عام بأنها تقوم بعقد ولو كان غير مكتوب، لكن هناك ما يشبه العقد الاجتماعي بينه وبين الشعب، أنا أحميكم وأقدم لكم الخدمات وأنتم تقدمون لي بالمقابل الولاء والطاعة، وبذلك تحتكر السلطة أيضا العنف لنفسها. وهذا كان من أهم المفاهيم الجديدة في العصر الحديث، والذي عمم من أوروبا باسم الحداثة على العالم كله، فصار من غير المشروع أن يمتلك أحد السلاح باستثناء الولايات المتحدة تحديدا، مع أنها هي رائدة العالم الحر، لكن أمريكا لها وضع خاص تطور تاريخيا واستمر على ما هو عليه. أما بالمجمل في المفهوم الحداثي، الحكومة هي التي تحتكر الجيش والسلطة والعنف، لكن الذي لم ينتبه إليه لدى هوبز وغيره أن السلطة هي أيضا التي لديها حق الحرب وحده، وأنها بعدما امتصت العنف من الداخل وفعلا أشاعت الأمن والسلام داخل حدود الدولة الواحدة، نتحدث هنا عن الغرب تحديدا وعن أوروبا، لكن هي في المقابل نقلت هذا العنف إلى الخارج، واحتكرت لنفسها أيضا الحق في إعلان الحرب على الآخرين، بل جعلت من هذا الحرب في بعض الأحيان مبررا لتكاتف المجتمع، حتى يبقى هذا المجتمع موجها لعنفه إلى الخارج، أما هو فيما بينه هو متحد أو على الأقل مسالم، يعني ما في حروب أهلية. مع ذلك أيضا كان فوكو ذكي في هذه النقطة لما قال أن الحداثة لم تكن تطبق بشكل كامل في العصر الحديث في أوروبا بهذا المعنى، ولكن أيضا كان فيها هذا الخلل في التطبيق في القرن العشرين نفسه لما رأينا الحربين العالميتين، وحتى كانت هناك حروب أهلية أيضا في بعض الدول الأوروبية. فإذا الحداثة ما كانت صافية وما كان فيها هذا المفهوم الصحيح لاحتكار العنف ومنعه من أن يتطور داخليا. من أهم إنتاجات فوكو وإبداعاته في نقد هذه الفلسفات القديمة ثم الإتيان بشيء جديد في هذا العصر، هو أنه بدأ يدرس السلطة من تحت، يعني هو ما كان يدرسها بشكل رأسي بأنها نتاج لعملية قهر من فوق إلى تحت، من السلطة العليا إلى الشعب، هو كان يرى السلطة موجودة في المجتمع كله بشكل أفقي، هي موجودة في المدرسة لما تطبع الطلاب بشكل معين لكي يكونوا مواطنين صالحين وتضع في رؤوسهم هذه الأفكار، كان يجدها أيضا في المستشفيات، كانت تطبق بعنف ضد بعض المرضى وخصوصا المرضى العقليين، تطبق أيضا في السجون ضد المساجين حتى لو ما كانوا مجرمين، هذا موضوع آخر. وهنا نأتي إلى أحد أهم كتبه المنشور في عام 1975، المراقبة والعقاب. هو هنا كان يرصد ما كان موجودا في الماضي، تحديدا عند الثورة الفرنسية لما كان العقاب يتم بعملية مسرحية، واستشهد بحالة معينة لما السلطة أمسكت بأحد المعتقلين وعاقبته بالتعذيب الوحشي على مسرح وأمام الناس، وهذا كان يتم في القرون الوسطى إلى الثورة الفرنسية. يقول بعد عقد فقط تغير هذا الوضع تماما، صارت السلطة تطبق القهر والعنف وربما حتى التعذيب، ولكن على الأرواح، على العقول، على النفسيات، وليس على الأجساد، وليس بهذا الشكل العلني. وهو يعتبر تقريبا النتيجة واحدة بل أكثر قهرا وتحكما وتسلطا على الناس، ولكن بطريقة ناعمة. من إنجازات فوكو أيضا أنه كان يستعمل منهج سماه الحفريات، مثل ما في حفريات أركيولوجية للبحث عن الآثار في الطبقات التي تحت الأرض، إما آثار أو أحافير لكائنات حية، هو أيضا اخترع هذا المنهج بالحفر في الأفكار، بمعنى تاريخ تشكل الأفكار وتاريخ تشكل المصطلحات. فهو كان يبحث مثلا في السلطة كيف تشكل مفهومها في السجن، في المستشفيات، في تاريخ الجنون مثلا كما بحث في أحد الكتب، وفي تطور النظام التعليمي والقهر الذي يطبق على الطلاب، كان يبحث في التاريخ كيف تشكل هذا المفهوم تاريخيا، وكيف هذا الطبقات هذه ما تتراكم بعضها فوق بعض تؤدي في النهاية إلى ما وصلنا إليه في عصرنا الحديث. فمثلا لما درس تاريخ الجنون قال في الماضي كان ينظر إلى الجنون على أنه شيء عظيم، هو عبارة عن اتصال بين المجنون وبين قوة عليا، فكان ينظر إلى المجنون بشيء من التبجيل. بدأت هذه الفكرة تتغير تماما، بمعنى أنه صار المجنون شخصية مدانة لأنها متصلة بالشياطين، فيعذب أحيانا تعذيب وحشي حتى تطرد منه الشياطين حتى لو كان هو غير واعي أصلا، لكنه شخصية شريرة. ثم يقول لك في العصر الحديث تغير هذا المفهوم تماما، فصار هذا المريض شخصية مريضة غير واعية وتذهب إلى المصحات النفسية والعقلية لتعالج، ليس لأننا متعاطفين معها ولكن لأنها غير واعية وتعالج بشكل إما كيميائي أو نفسي. هو يقول هنا طريقة التعامل مع هذه الشخصيات تخضع للسلطة نفسها، السلطة هي التي تغير الفكرة، تغير طريقة التعامل مع أي شيء. وبالعودة لكتاب المراقبة والعقاب، في بداية الكتاب أيضا ليس فقط كان يقارن بين التعذيب وغيره، لكنه أيضا حتى كان يدرس السجن نفسه كيف تغير، واستشهد فوكو بنموذج للسجن اقترحه جيرمي بنتم فيلسوف أيضا بريطاني راحل، كان اسمه بانوبتيكون. هذا السجن عبارة عن شكل دائري فيه برج في الوسط، في هذا البرج هناك مراقب أو حارس، وكل المساجين موجودين في زنازين فردية على المحيط، وهناك فتحة في الطرف الذي في الخارج وفتحة في الطرف الذي في الداخل، بمعنى أن الضوء يدخل من الخارج إلى الداخل. هذا يؤدي إلى أن الشخص الموجود في الزنزانة عبارة عن شخص موجود في مكان يملأه الضوء، فكل ما يفعله هذا الشخص خاضع للمراقبة. بمعنى تخيل أنك موجود في مكان فيه كاميرا مراقبة في عصرنا الحديث. بالنتيجة، مع أنه طبعا هذا السجن كما يقال لم يطبق، ولأنه أظن أنه طبق مرة واحدة، لكن المهم أنه الفكرة هي أن هذا الشخص سيكون في كل الفترة التي سيقضي فيها، فترة الحبس ولو كانت لسنين طويلة، برمج عقله على أنه كل حركة في حياته 24 ساعة مراقبة. هذا ينفي الخصوصية وينفي كرامة الإنسان. فيقول فوكو هذا في النهاية انتقل من فكرة المراقبة داخل السجن إلى المجتمع كله، فنحن في كل المجتمع نعيش في نفس فكرة المراقبة. وهذا كان كما ألف هذا الكتاب في السبعينات قبل انتشار كاميرات المراقبة الآن ومواقع التواصل اللي موجودة معنا في جيوبنا كل لحظة، ونحن الآن صار عندنا مؤكد أن هذه الكاميرات التي في هذه الأجهزة تراقبنا وتصورنا وتسجل أحاديثنا وتراقب سلوكياتنا والأماكن اللي ننتقلها عبر الأقمار الصناعية، كل شيء تقريبا مراقب. ولو أرادوا أن يراقبوا شخصا بعينه فيمكن أن يعرفوا أدق تفاصيل حياته. لكن هو كان يبحث الأثر الفلسفي والنفسي والذي كان يطبق باسم القانون عبر هذه الآليات. ولا ننسى أنه هذا الانتقال من السلطة الغاشمة الخشنة إلى السلطة الناعمة، والسيطرة على الأجساد إلى السيطرة على العقول والحرية والإرادة كما يقول فوكو، النقطة هنا هي أنه هذا الأمر انتقل من ذلك العصر السابق إلى العصر الحديث عبر فلسفة الفردانية، واللي هي تعتبر من أهم إنجازات العصر الحديث، اللي هي أنه أنت كفرد أنت الجوهر، أنت المركز، أنت أهم شيء، أنت أهم من المجتمع كله، على أساس أننا نعيش الآن في حقبة حقوق الإنسان واحترام الإنسان وحرية التعبير، وأنه هذا المجتمع هو قاهر ومتسلط عليك. الذي لم ينتبه له الناس هو أن هذا كان عبارة عن خدعة. طبعا فوكو لا يقول هذا بهذه المصطلحات، النتيجة هو أيضا خاضع للنظام الليبرالي وهو ابن هذا النظام ومتمسك بنتائجه بشكل عام، لكن هو أيضا انتبه إلى أنه الفلسفة الفردانية كانت بداية لتشكل هذا النظام. وأنا هنا أضيف من عندي، لما الفلسفة الفردانية الليبرالية هذه عزلت الإنسان عن مجتمعه، المجتمع هذا اللي كان يقال له أنه هو المتسلط عليك والذي يحرمك من حقوقك من تفكيرك الحر، المجتمع هذا في نفس الوقت أيضا كان يحميك، مع أنه كان له سلطة عليك، ربما كان يقهرك ببعض الأشياء لكنه أيضا كان يحميك من سلطة الدولة. فالآن الدولة هي المتحكم فيك، هي التي تصوغ أفكارك في المدرسة كما قلنا، ثم تتحكم فيك في المستشفى وفي العيادات وفي السجون، والآن في الإعلام، وهي التي تشكل كل المفاهيم العامة، هي التي تقول لك من هو العدو ومن هو الصديق، من هي الدولة التي نعاديها ويجب أن نحاربها أصلا، وما هو الصح وما هو الخطأ، وما هو الحق وما هو الباطل، ما هو الشر وما هو الخير. هذا كله الآن تحدده الحكومات حتى في أكثر الدول ليبرالية وحرية وانفتاحا. فوكو كان دقيقا وكان واضحا لما شبه المدرسة بثكنة عسكرية، هي تصوغ عقول الأطفال بطريقة بعيدة تماما عن الإبداع عن التفكير الحر. الآن مثلا هذا من عندي، لا يمكن أبدا الآن في أمريكا تحديدا اللي فيها نسبة متدينة من المجتمع، ولا أقول فرنسا، لا يمكن تدريس نظرية التصميم الذكي، لازم كل الطلاب يدرسوا فقط نظرية التطور هي التفسير العلمي الوحيد، مع أنه المتدينين في فترة ما حاولوا عبر القضاء أنه يقنعوا فقط النظام التعليمي بأنه هذه نظرية أخرى، فقط لو سمحتوا اسمحوا لنا بتعليمها للأطفال حتى يعرفوا أنه في نظرية أخرى، في نظرية التطور، في نظرية الخلق أو التصميم الذكي. ممنوع، يجب أن يكون العلم رافضا لأي تفسير غيبي، ومع أنه نظرية التطور أصلا هي نظرية غيبية في النهاية، لأنك أنت لا تستطيع أن ترصد إطلاقا بشكل علمي ولا أن تلاحظ التطورات التي تحدث والتي يفترض أنها حدثت عبر انتقال من نوع إلى نوع آخر. وعلى فكرة، مع أني خرجت الآن عن الموضوع، هذه كانت من أهم المآخذ الذي أخذها كارل بوبر، وهو من أهم فلاسفة العلم الحديث، أخذها على نظرية التطور باعتبارها كما يقول نظرية ميتافيزيقية غيبية، لا يمكن أن ترصد ولا يمكن أن تبحث علميا ولا يمكن أن نعطيها حتى صفة النظرية العلمية. طبعا الوقت لا يسمح للتعرض لكل أفكار فوكو، فيها الكثير من الإيجابيات في النقد لهذه الأفكار التي كانت تعتبر مسلم بها في النظرية الليبرالية، وأيضا كان لها انتقادات على نيتشه وماركس وغيره، لكن أيضا لا يمكن أن نغفل الجانب الشخصي في حياة فوكو. وهنا أشير إلى آخر سيرة ذاتية كتبت لميشيل فوكو، نشرت عام 93 للمؤلف جيمس ميلر، وكان اسمها شهوة ميشيل فوكو. طبعا فوكو كان يعلن أنه مثلي الجنس، وهذا ما كان شائعا ولا مقبولا في تلك الفترة، لكن طبعا هو كان خارج كل هذه السياقات، كان متمردا بالمطلق على الكثير من الأفكار وخاصة الدينية والأخلاقية، فطبعا ما كان عنده مشكلة في الإعلان عن ذلك، وكان لديه من يدعمه في هذا التوجه. لكن هو أيضا كان بيدوفيل، كان من من وقعوا على عريضة تطالب الحكومة بحرية ممارسة الجنس مع الأطفال، وكان يمارسه فعلا، وهذا ما افتضح مؤخرا قبل أشهر فقط لما نشر في صحيفة التايمز البريطانية نقلا عن أحد أصدقائه اللي صار الآن عمره 77 سنة، يقول لما زاروه في تونس، لما عاش سنتين في تونس تحديدا في قرية بوسعيد، اكتشفوا ورأوا بأعينهم، ذهبوا عدد أصدقائه كان معهم محررين وصحفيين ومراسلين، وجدوه كيف الأطفال بلاحقوه ويقولون له خذني أنا أيضا، وهو كان يلقي عليهم المال ويقول لهم اذهبوا إلى المكان الفلاني الذي نتواعد فيه كل يوم، وكان عبارة عن مقبرة يمارس فيها هذه الفاحشة مع هؤلاء الأطفال. هو ليس كان فقط مثلي، ولكن أيضا كان يفعل هذا مع الأطفال، وهذا حتى الآن، حتى الآن بعد كل هذه السنوات، حتى الآن ما زال يعتبر جريمة، ولو أنه كما يبدو سيصبح مشروعا أخلاقيا وقانونيا قريبا في بعض الدول الغربية كما يبدو. طبعا هناك من يقول أنه من روى هذه القصة لم يؤكدها، ما أحضر أي دليل على ذلك، لكن الذي كتب سيرته الذاتية قال أنه كان في آخر أيامه لما أصيب الإيدز، وكان هو يعني معروف أنه سيذهب إلى الموت، كان أول سؤال سأله كم بقي لي من الحياة، وألف كتابه عن الجنس في تلك الفترة، والتي نقد فيها أيضا أفكار الجنس والجنسانية وتاريخ الجنسانية من منطلقاته وحفرياته أيضا، لكن ظل حتى آخر يوم في حياته يمارس شهواته بعربدته وبأقصى ما يمكن، كما يقول ميلر ظل يمارسها بدرجة متطرفة في آخر أيام وكأنه كان يسابق الزمن. ويقول أيضا أن بعض أصدقائه كانوا يحذرونه من مغبة هذه الممارسات على صحته ليس على أخلاقه وروحه، ومع ذلك كان هواه غلابا. الآن قد يقال اعزلوا أفكاره عن سلوكه وعن أخلاقه، المشكلة أنه فوكو نفسه كما يقول ميلر، هو نفسه كان يصرح في مناسبات كثيرة أنكم لا يمكن أن تفهموا أفكار شخص ما إلا بعد فهم ميوله الجنسية تحديدا، فإذا هذا يعني، وكما هو اعترف أيضا لعشيقه كما يقول المؤلف، هو اعترف بأن الكثير من أفكاره كانت عبارة عن سيرة ذاتية له هو، بمعنى أن هذه الأفكار وهذه الفلسفة هي نتيجة وانعكاس لحياته الشخصية، لأفكاره، لميوله، لعربدته أيضا. في النهاية توفي فوكو عن عمر 57 سنة في عام 1984، وكان كما يقول صديقه الذي فضحه في المجلة أو في صحيفة تايمز، كان يقول أنه لم يكن أحد يجرؤ على أن يفضح ما حدث، اللي شافوا تلك القصة في تونس ما ذكروها ولم تفضح إلا الآن، لأنه كما يقول كان يعتبر في فرنسا مثل الإله. أنا هنا أريد أن أقف عند هذه النقطة، لماذا اعتبروه إلها مع أنه كان ينتقد الليبرالية نفسها، كان ينتقد الفلسفة الحداثية، وحتى بما أنه من رواد ما بعد الحداثة فما عنده مسلمات، ما عنده قاعدة يرتكز عليها. الجواب باختصار هو أنه لو انتقد أفكار الحداثة والليبرالية من منطلق ديني، لا أقول إسلامي، ولكن حتى من منطلق كاثوليكي، والكاثوليكية هي الدين الأساسي في فرنسا، هنا ما كانوا سيسمحون له. لكن بما أنه كان ينتقد من منطلق ما بعد حداثي وإلحادي، فليقل ما شاء، وسيجعلون منه إلها وينصبون له أيضا الأصنام ويسمون الشوارع باسمه. هذه كانت باختصار وجبة فكرية أرجو أن تكون مفيدة، مع أنها قد تكون دسمة لحد ما، حاولت أن أبسط فيها أفكار فوكو ومدرسة فوكو وما بعد فوكو. شكرا لمتابعتكم، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. My dear brothers and sisters, today I want to, tackle a very sensitive topic, a sensitive issue, actually. And this issue is related to the unfortunate incident that happened last Friday in Pakistan. I know that people are emotionally charged and people may have to justify, explain, show displeasure, whatever the case may be. So please allow me to share my viewpoint on what happened. Now, what happened is, in my vocabulary, a mob attack. And mob justice, vigilante justice, have no place in Islam. No matter what happened, no matter how severe we may interpret an act as blasphemous, as unacceptable, in Islam, it is not right. It is totally unacceptable for people to take the law into their own hand. This is our deen. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the ruler, gave the judge, that right to pass the judgment, and on behalf of those who were affected by that action, they will act. Now, for mobs from the street to become the judge, to become the jury and the executioner is completely out of the realm of our deen, Islam. Again, please understand where I'm coming from. I'm here to share my sincere views on what happened, because, you know, what happened left an impact on many groups within the society in the Western world. We have been trying to fight Islamophobia for the longest time. And every time we advance one step, we find ourselves retreating 10 steps. And this makes our fight against Islamophobia so much more difficult. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is, you know, something I want to mention from the seerah of our beloved Prophet, to show that on a similar occasion, he distanced himself, he dissociated himself from something which was completely unacceptable. This is narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari through the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar narrates that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent Khalid ibn al-Walid on a contingent to Bani Jazima to invite them to Islam. While Khalid and the group with him were trying to do this in a disciplined manner, some people from Bani Jazima, started a riot, and they almost, caused many members of the Muslim contingency lots of harm. Khalid ibn al-Walid made a judgment to fight back, and he killed many among those people who started the riot. Then he captured a few of them and gave each member of his contingency a captive to keep. After a few days, he ordered those members to kill the captive, because he felt that those captives were inciting another riot. Now, Abdullah ibn Umar says that he refused to do that because a captive has rights in Islam. And when there was disagreement between him and Khalid, he went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him what happened. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon hearing what happened, he was sitting, he stood up, and he raised his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this fashion, and he said, Allahumma inni abra'u ilayka mimma sana'a Khalid. Oh Allah, I dissociate myself from that which was committed by Khalid. So he went public to show that he did not approve of a wrong act. And that is why today, you know, وَلَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ, with the same principles upheld by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, I felt that I need to go public to dissociate myself personally from that which was committed, because what was committed was wrong. Because, you know, if we really wanted to do something right, you know, we should have taken this to the police, and the police would take it to a court of law, and then we will deal with it. Now, for those people who did not know what happened in Pakistan last Friday, let me tell you that there was a general manager of a fabrics factory who was not a Muslim. He was a Christian from Sri Lanka, and he passed a rule that no posters may be hung on the walls of the factory. When he saw posters being placed on the walls, he went and he took them to keep his rule in check. Now, some of the workers felt that that was blasphemous, because those posters praised Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, some details mention that the general manager did not know that he did not understand Urdu, the written. He could speak it, but he could not read it. Whatever the details may be, I just want to say that what happened after that was completely wrong, because they dragged this general manager and they beat him up, then they killed him and they burnt his body. Now, there's nowhere in Islam that we may find justification for such a heinous crime. And I say, I repeat, that was a crime. You know, according to Islam, we have laws, we have rules. Now, people may ask, are there blasphemy laws that are in effect in Islam? The answer is yes, there are blasphemy laws, but these laws are interpreted differently among the different schools of thought. Now, even though Imam Shafi'i and Imam Ibn Hanbal and Imam Malik, you know, have a common understanding how to apply those blasphemy laws, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, those blasphemy laws do not apply to non-Muslims. We cannot use them against non-Muslims. And Al-Imam Al-Kasani, who is a very well-known Hanafi scholar, mentions something in this regard. He says, what more blasphemous than a non-Muslim declaring that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was telling a lie, that he was not a prophet, that he was staging something which is not factual? That is the ultimate blasphemy. And if a non-Muslim believes in that, now anything that he would say would not add to his status of being blasphemous. So the laws do not apply to such people, even if they live in Muslim lands. So we cannot justify seeing those Muslims, and there were close to 400 of them, who were shouting, Labbayka ya Muhammad, Labbayka ya Rasulallah, Takbir, Allahu Akbar. And some of them were taking selfies with the burnt body. How terrible that would be. And let me ask, now, do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was happy with such acts? Do you think that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would approve of such a response to what happened? The answer, in my estimate, from what I know, is absolutely not. Because to declare something as blasphemous, and again, putting the interpretation of Imam Abu Hanifa aside, I would say that to declare something blasphemous, even according to the other three schools of thought, that blasphemy has to be unambiguous. It has to be very explicit, that there's no doubt that everybody would interpret that as blasphemy. Like, for example, what that priest did when he burnt the Quran in Florida. That nobody can argue with that. However, the second condition is that the intention of the person committing that blasphemous act has to be very clear, that he or she intended to commit that act. If, for example, someone is holding the Quran and the Quran is slipped from his hand or her hand, fell on the floor in a disrespectful manner, the intention was not there. We cannot call that as blasphemy. So we have to understand what happened and act. And even when we are ready to act against that blasphemous act, it is the ruler, it is the judge, it is not the people in the street who have the right to do that. And in conclusion, I would like to say that even there were incidents in the life, during the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam modified the application of the general rules in order to divert mafsada and to bring something good to the community. Now, dar'ul mafasid muqaddamun ala jalb al masalih. And this is a general rule in Islam, because if we will do something according to a rule of fiqh, and that thing is going to lead to a worse situation, then we may modify the way we will interpret our fiqh of that situation. Now, let me mention that Sharia is immutable. It never changes. However, fiqh changes all the time. And I've mentioned this, I believe, even on a previous episode of Muslim Do. Now, to give an example to really explain this, consider what happened when Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, during the Ghazwa of Bani al-Mustaliq, or Ghazwat al-Muraysiya, he incited a kind of a fitna, a kind of a sedition, where he almost engaged the Muhajirin and the Ansar in a quarrel, in a fitna between each other, because he started telling people that those Muslims who came from Mecca started all but trouble for us, and they took our wealth, they did this, they did that. And some of the people of Medina, the Ansar, started to believe his rhetoric. Umar ibn al-Khattab heard that, and he said, "Da'ni adrib 'unuqahu ya Rasulullah," let me separate his head from his body, O Messenger of Allah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look how he modified that rule, which is to impose the punishment of killing the person, the munafiq, the hypocrite, because this is the punishment that is imposed on a hypocrite. And we know that Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul was declared as the head of nifaq, as the head of hypocrisy. However, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Da'ahu ya Umar, la yuhadithu an-nas anna Muhammadan yaqtulu ashabah." He said, "Don't do that, Umar, because I don't want people who did not know about the circumstances of what happened say that Muhammad is in the habit of murdering his own companions. They will not understand what happened. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam modified the rule as if to say modified the fiqh. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everything he did not need our fiqh, because he was the source of fiqh, the source of sharia after the Quran. However, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the example. Another time when he arrived in Mecca, when he liberated Mecca, he told his wife Aisha, had your people, that is Quraysh, not been nascent or recent in the way they accepted Islam, I would have demolished the Kaaba as it is now, because it was short 3 meters from Hijr Ismail, the way it used to be on the foundations established by Ibrahim alayhi salam. I would have demolished the Kaaba as it is and rebuilt it on the original foundations of Ibrahim. And I would have made 2 doors, the same as Ibrahim alayhi salam did, one for people to enter from and one for people to exit from. But I'm not going to do that, because my action, my right action, would be misinterpreted by the people of Quraysh. So he modified his decision in order to keep things in check. And that is what we really need to do, even if the laws of blasphemy applied today, we need to modify our understanding of them. We need to establish goodness instead of establishing lots of turmoil, as we are seeing all over the Muslim world, because we are just stuck on establishing enmity with others without trying to follow the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us that which is good and guide us to follow it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us that which is bad and help us to avoid it. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone. Welcome to Muslim Dudes Success Stories. And in particular, with success stories, we want to highlight and spotlight Muslim figures in the community who are doing amazing, amazing work. And mashallah, with me here today is none other than Sister Nargis from My Voice Magazine. Mashallah, she's done a ton of work in the community. How's it going, Sister Nargis?
Assalamu alaikum. Everything is well, alhamdulillah. Thank you so much.
Oh, it's going to be fun, mashallah. And when it comes to the youth, you know, planning ahead, and especially with a magazine, you know, that's something that you hear time and time again with investing in the youth. Youth are our future, creativity outlets. I guess to start off this conversation, in a nutshell, for those who aren't aware of what My Voice is all about, it's always a great idea to hear the founder story, the origin story. How did you come up with this? And we'll unpack the conversation from there.
Well, actually, I was asked to emcee a thinking retreat of all the imams in the GTA in 2011. And as I was emceeing, I actually heard them talk about a survey that was done in North America where 95% of Muslim youth were saying that they feel detached from their religion, from their faith. And that was a shock to me because my children were younger at that time. They were not teenagers as yet, but it was something I never even thought about. So from there led this whole discovery of, let's figure out what these kids want. Why are they feeling so detached? What's the identity crisis about? And 2013, after doing the survey and talking to teenagers, we decided, okay, let's launch this magazine where you will design, you will write whatever you want, you will edit, you will run the entire show, you will run the entire organization. And at the time, of course, I didn't realize it, but alhamdulillah, what it also did is, number one, it built their confidence, built their skills in running an organization. But at the same time, when people picked up a magazine that looked all creative and artsy by these youth, they learned about Muslims in a very beautiful and artistic way. It was fighting Islamophobia even before we realized it was fighting Islamophobia. So basically 8 and a half years ago, that's how the story started.
Amazing, mashallah. So just to pause for a second, it wasn't like you were planning on this and this was your dream from day one. Like, you know, some folks, like Masha, we had other guests like Muhammad Salah from Masrawi, and even like, you know, the restaurant wasn't something that was in the works. Like it was happenstance, and it was a consequence of something else. So Marshall, you started with emceeing. You figured out there was a need. What were some of the things that you've noticed? You mentioned like identity. Could you expand a bit about that when it comes to identity and what the Muslim youth were particularly facing that prompted you to start saying, let's look at some other avenues and creative outlets like magazines?
Well, the thing is that I've always believed in a very hands-on approach where you give autonomy and you let children and youth not, you don't dictate to them, but you actually let them explore and guide them. So in terms of my voice, when I was talking to these teenagers, a lot of them were talking about how they felt that, what is their identity? Are we Muslim? Are we Canadian? Are we from back home? Our parents keep on saying, well, back home, this is how we did things, but now we're in Canada. So it was all muddled up. So I felt that if they let out and unleash their creativity in whatever way, they don't just write, they also do creativity in illustrations or video creation. So they would feel comfortable. And teenage years are a very sensitive age. If you just give them that space, they will bloom. It's like a caterpillar. I always tell parents, if the caterpillar is in a cocoon and it's fighting to become that butterfly, you don't mess with it. You let it struggle and you give it the right environment so that it becomes a butterfly. And, you know, I have seen so many of these caterpillars turn into butterflies in the past 8 years, alhamdulillah.
MashaAllah, look at that. What a nice, look at that. Look at that, like with the caterpillar and the butterfly. And okay, so let's see. Can you give an example just for folks to get a real tangible taste of, I mean, I'm sure there are countless, if off the top of your head, is there anyone, any particular, you can keep them anonymous if anything, but has there been a situation where you looked at a particular youth where it was like, wow, a complete 180, or what a success story, or just amazing transformation all in all, just simply because they participated in something like this?
I have. So there's a few people who have written to me and come to me after just participating a few years into the magazine and into the organization. And they said that when we walked in, to us, it was just something to do, a volunteer experience, getting our hours for high school. And then after that, we realized that the struggles we're having at home with our parents, with our teachers, with just our religion, I'm questioning so many things. We found the answer. It made us stronger. At the same time, there was a lot of people who got scholarships because they were able to write on the resume the skills that they gained as, you know, our outreach coordinator. So, I mean, the skills that these kids are getting literally at high school level here are what they would get after they graduate and they walk around trying to get a job. And at that job, they would be saying, what's your previous experience? There's two kids who actually came to me and said, we applied for medical school, and we all know how hard that is in Canada. They got in to two or three of them, and each time the interviewer was asking them, what did you do at My Voice? Another girl who got into law school, and she said, the whole conversation with my interviewer for this application was about My Voice and what I did. So I hear these every time. It's a lot of work being the only adult. And I often think, how can I offload this to somebody else? Because I didn't realize it would be so much work. Then I hear these testimonials and I say, okay, you know what? Let me just continue and find a way out. So alhamdulillah.
MashaAllah. Okay, so, you know, there's that link there. You get these skills, these soft skills, and even some tangible skills like writing and expressing your creativity, exercising those muscles, letting them bloom. Have you seen anything like this? I mean, when it comes to youth magazines, you know how, for instance, again, using the restaurants as an example, you look to your left, you look to your right, you know, they pop up here and there. Have you seen anything like this that you took as an example or not? And if not, why isn't there more of these kind of initiatives being put forth?
So just last week, I had a meeting with some of the young professionals that I recruited this year to advise and mentor the different teams of youth. And I said to them, you know, this is so much work, raising funds for it, all the work that we do. Is if there's other opportunities out there in the market, maybe we should just merge with them rather than, you know, duplicating the effort. And they said, please don't do that. There's nothing out there. We really love this initiative. So yes, we have looked around because honestly speaking, as I said to you, it was not a planned effort. It was not something, if I had actually known how much work it would be, I think I would not have started it just because of work. But it's not like that. And the reason I feel is because parents and adults want to tell the youth what to do. They do not understand that you can't preach at that age. You just need to let them be creative and give them a very safe environment. And if you do that, There's actually a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that up until the age of 7, you play with your child. The next 7 years, you teach them. But the 7 years after, you become their friend. And that's something we forget. When they become teenagers and they're struggling in their little cocoon, we actually want to fix them and we want to say, what's wrong with my kid? Why is he being moody or she's doing this? We don't understand that they need that 7 years for you to be their friend. And friends don't get strict and tell you what to do. They listen to you and they try to understand you.
Interesting. So giving that space. All right. No, you mentioned about that space. Can you elaborate a bit more? What kind of environment, or you can say, quote unquote, work culture, you can, although it's nonprofit, it's volunteer based. What is the type of environment that you've created, mashallah, along with the help of, you know, teammates that allow the youth to blossom and bloom and grow?
So the magazine team, which consists of editor-in-chief and head editors, designers, illustrators, and section editors, they're all young high school or university students, right? So they have to have a quarterly meeting to discuss the theme. They invite and open it to other youth. So that's the product that they create, the way they do it. But then underneath that, just like in any organization, you need to have departments, the finance department, the administration department, the marketing department. One youth said, I want to start building the app for it. So getting them the right softwares, getting them the right trainings, finding people who can either teach them or letting them learn themselves. Whenever they say, I want to do something, I don't shut them down. I have a discussion. I say, okay, look at the pros and cons. Do what you have to. One girl wanted to do a TV show. She did a 13 episode TV show in a studio. It's called the My Voice Show, and you can find it on our YouTube channel. I said, go ahead. You know, I'll help you, but it's your idea. You go with it. So I think it's just the fact that they feel I have an idea, I can go with it, and I'll get some help when I need it. And no one's going to tell me not to do it. The only place I do keep an eye out is if when they do something that could get them in trouble, either through not doing it Islamically correctly, or if they might say something that could get them politically in trouble. So I keep an eye out for that. But other than that, they're free to do whatever they want.
Interest. So there are. So Hamza, so it sounds like ownership is the big key here. When you really own the project that you put your mind to, and you just go press forth with that, you really cultivate that sense of, all right, let's make it happen. Let's see, here are the tools, here are the resources. You want to make a TV show? All right, great. Let's put the resources together. Is that accurate? Like, you're really cultivating that whole, let's see how we can make this become a reality, as opposed to just shutting them down from the get-go and say, yep, this isn't going to work. Don't do it. We don't have the money. We don't have the funds. We don't have this. We don't have that. Like, as so many others, is that a fair way of saying how it describes the overall environment?
It is, for sure. And funds has always been a big deal. It has been something that we have to do throughout the year, raise funds. We do launch good campaigns in Ramadan and everything. I feel it's a very expensive project, but at the same time, it's a miracle that somehow we break even. Somehow, alhamdulillah, we're even able to send Eid gift cards to all these volunteers, you know? So it turns out well. The first 5 years, I should mention, some one of the projects that I want to bring back is a stage plays. So we had a girl who loves writing scripts for stage plays. And so we got these kids together. They acted. One of the plays, actually, Muslim Fest found out about it. They said, could you repeat it at Muslim Fest? And we did that as well. They were phenomenal. They were amazing. And I'd like that project to actually start again.
Wow, there you go. So there's one thing in the pipeline, but let's pull back the curtain a little bit. You mentioned and you hinted at the fact that if you knew then what you know now, you probably wouldn't have started, given the mountainous task of putting something like this together as an initiative. What are some of the challenges, if you can be candid in sharing, about what it takes to actually run this youth organization, especially for My Voice? Because, you know, things don't just happen out of thin air. There's work, there's effort, there's things to be put in place. Can you share some insights as to what is it like in the kitchen, so to speak?
For sure. Basically, number one, as I mentioned, raising the funds. Being an adult in the organization, it's pretty much my job to do that. Secondly, there's always things like I'm a little bit of a perfectionist when it comes to doing anything from the banner of Islam or Muslims. So I have to make sure that these kids, whatever they put out there, has to look really good. You know, you have to read or watch whatever it is, has to be done really well as it could be. Then, of course, there's team meetings, getting them to do things outside of their homework and projects. Teenagers get distracted a lot. And I think having 30, 40, 50 under you and chasing after them, it keeps you up at night. And sure, things get done on time. And of course, you know, if you say 1st of December, the next issue is going to be out, then things have to fall in place with time. So just teaching them time management. It's always constantly mentoring and teaching, and it's not one or two youth. So, you know, at home you have 3 or 4 teenagers maximum at one go, but here it's a lot. So yeah, it just, and then on top of that, I have a family and I have a job too. So this being volunteer work, it turns out to be a mountainous type of a pile on my head and shoulders.
But Marshall, to reinvigorate as a, you know, the mission of why you're doing this in the first place, you seeing those letters of appreciation, you're not doing it for the appreciation or a letter, but just seeing the fruits of your labor, Marshall, I'm sure it invigorates you, no?
It does. Every single time I think that's what God does, that every time I think, oh my God, this is too much, I should probably shed it, my mental health is important, I get one of these testimonials. Sometimes I get them from non-Muslims who have just picked it up at the library and have said, we had no idea that Muslim youth were writing such amazing things and we felt such a connection. And I say to myself, you know, what's the purpose of my life if I'm not giving back to community? And it's not supposed to be easy to do that, right? It is supposed to be a little bit of hard work. So alhamdulillah, for as long as I have the energy and mental capacity, I will continue. But I would like to have other adults who are like-minded to come and support it. And I'm trying to build that team now.
Okay. So maybe let's, before we move on to other areas of discussion, maybe now is a good time to share what are some resources that you feel like would be great, like for those listening and for those in the community and beyond, because now the world is ever so connected. Maybe you never know who can help. What are some things you mentioned that you want to build a team? If you could list off, I guess, off the top, what would be some things that would really take my voice to the next level and what's needed to get there?
We do need some. I would love to have a business consultant who can come and sit and understand the project and see how we can make it sustainable rather than always looking for funds. Just raising funds and asking for donations gets to be a lot. And if there's some way that we can do it better to make it a long-term sustainable project, that would be great. I would love to have other professionals who feel that, you know, I can be an advisor to the app team. I could be an advisor to the marketing team and just be there. Maybe even help us raise those funds or find sponsors. That would be excellent. I just need adults. But these adults, when they come and they see the work, they actually just drop the ball and run away. I want people who realize it's going to be work. Working with teenagers and youth is challenging. You do have to run after them and you should be willing to run after them. And if you're okay with that and you have the patience, then yes, I would love to have that help.
Okay, Marshall. So there's that call out for those folks. If your name is written on that, then it sounds like something to consider and reach out for sure. And so now, I guess shifting gears for another moment when it comes to the youth particularly, especially given the fact that a lot of this, well, this is actually 100% revolving around youth. Are there any top misconceptions that you've noticed when it comes to our Muslim youth? Maybe some things that are tossed around, you know, for one thing you mentioned about, not necessarily a misconception, but at one point you remarked about how parents, sometimes we talk at our teens as opposed to letting them develop and grow and giving them that space. What are some other, maybe misconceptions is one thing, or what are some other areas of observations that you notice that, you know, on the one side it looks like this, but actually based on experience it's this?
Yes. So one of the reasons that I did start this magazine, it was because one of those, I was hearing those misconceptions, and some of them were not misconceptions because a lot of our teenagers were calling our school boards and complaining about their parents. So when you hear that, you go in shock and think, what is the world coming to? What is happening to our teenagers? What are we doing wrong? All of that, right? And we blame the culture. We blame, oh, we should have not come to Canada or something like that. But the reality is, that if you treat somebody with love and kindness and give them space and hear them out and understand that their generation and your generation are different, the times you lived in and the times they're living in are different. And you as parents do need to understand, and adults do need to understand, what part of your deen is, you know, applicable in haram and halal, black and white. But not everything is that. We use these words really loosely, and that's what keeps our children away from us, drags them down. We get angry at them rather than trying to understand them. I feel dealing with these youth, they're very creative. They just want to be respected. They want to be heard. They're really good kids, really, really good kids. I love all of them. And I think about each one of them, and I really feel this affection as if they were my own children. That is just something you don't feel if they were really that bad. You know, you want to wipe your hands off of them, but that doesn't happen with me. Once in a while, you might find a difficult child, but I'm also a life coach, and I get parents bringing their kids to me, and I realize it's the parents who need the coaching first before the kid does.
Real okay. All right, let's continue that train of thought, because let's just say, for instance, that you have a, you know, we're not painting everyone with the same brush, and we don't want to paint a bleak picture. However, it would be naive of us to say that all Muslim parents, all Muslim kids are on the right track and everything is all going smoothly. No, there are some troubles that happen. So what would you say? Okay, let's continue that train of thought about the parents who need life coaching. And let's just say you have a teen who's on the rocks, the folk who's on the edge, that's maybe not making the greatest of choices and life decisions. And what could my voice do? I mean, have you seen anything like that, like as a transformation? Yeah, feel free to carry on with that.
There was a girl who joined our team at that point. I think she had just done her high school, and she had joined, I don't want to say the name of the institute, but it's only religion institute, where you do 1 or 2 years of course in your faith, learning the aqidah and all that. And so she was from a very religious family. Her abaya, everything was there. And on the surface, you would think, okay, good family, religion, everything. But she came to me, and her writing, her articles were very rebellious, and they were against her mom and her dad. And I had to actually correct them. I had to say, you can say these things, just be polite. These are still your parents. So after a year and a half, she came back to me and she said, you have no idea how much this calmed me down, this experience, and how much it made me understand how to deal with the problems I'm having at home. So as long as I'm able to reach that student nowadays, year and a half in COVID, sometimes you don't understand on Zoom what's actually happening. So that connection has not been as strong. But when we used to do in-person meetings and events, I could just sense looking at the person that there's some problem happening. I need to have a chat with them. And I did that. But if the parents come to me and if they bring their kids, I always say to them, start with apologizing to your child. Your child is not acting in a vacuum. Something happened the way you treated them. Start, sit down, acknowledge that, yes, the way I treated you was wrong. And I'm so sorry. I'm a human being. And then we take it from there.
Interesting. Khair. So, I mean, yeah, I don't know what to say about the folks who are on the outside. Everything seems to be nice and shiny and well, but then deep down inside, there's some things behind closed doors, skeletons in the closet, so to speak. Now, you mentioned that when you can look at certain, I guess, Marshall, now with your years of experience in dealing with youth, there are probably some patterns. Are there any telltale signs that when you have a youth, brand new youth, a young man or a young woman, and they just come to you, are there any things that you particularly look out for and are warning signs, red flags, where you're like, okay, this could be someone who has some inner demons that they need to face, or have some situations that they're repressing and things of that nature? Is there anything like that that you can point to as, you know, telltale signs that this particular teen is in this situation?
Yes, there's a couple of different signs. Either the child will be so quiet and so timid and trying to hide so that nobody picks on them, that you could see that confidence and that love was not given at home, or something happened in school. Because naturally, you should see by the time the children are teenagers, there should be some form of confidence, just sitting there with your back straight or something like that, right? But if you're trying to hide behind people, not understanding, not making eye contact, there's that. Then there's the other child who comes in and they are being cocky about adults, about clothes, trying to make fun, do little tidbits of rebellious remarks about the dean or about their adults. And you could tell that they're hating on somebody in their mind because that somebody has hurt them. And because of that, they're associating the rest of their culture or their religion with that. So, you know, the body language, some of the words they say makes, you could tell.
So can you give an example of, let's say, about the remarks that you, that someone might be saying that are poking fun at the dean or at a particular adult? Is there any, well, again, keeping people anonymous, just so that we can get a real, so you mentioned body language and, you know, the timidness. Is there any verbalized, is there any patterns of words that are being tossed around that you've seen that, you know, that perks your ears up?
There's nothing specific. I think, first of all, it happened a couple of years ago and ever since then. But that girl that I remember, she left after a while. She did not want to stay because obviously if you have 15, 20 kids in the room, no matter what I say, she's not getting that one-on-one time, nor is she wanting it. She needs help or he needs help. So when she did come and she was being very loud, or she was mocking, what is modesty anyway? What is this whole deal with hijab? And you don't really need to wear one to be a good Muslim. And I said, yeah, that's true. You're right. But we don't really need to fight about it. Like, we don't need to argue about it. We could just accept it. You could be the best Muslim ever without wearing your hijab, and that's fine. But do we need to bring it up and make a big fuss about it right now? And just that alone helped me realize that there was some force in the house. Maybe somebody, and I recently have had a couple of kids come to me and they tell me that their parents make very racist remarks against other cultures. And this is Muslims. And so they're growing up in an environment where that's not tolerated. Islam doesn't tolerate it. But then the parents are using Islam as an example. So there's a lot of mixed messages. And if we're not honest with our children, if we're not pure with our children are not going to respect us. And hence, because of that, by association, they will not respect the culture we're from.
I see. Now, speaking of the Muslim community in general, Masha, it sounds like, you know, my voice is, correct me if I'm wrong, more along the lines in the category of like the arts, no? Like it's something along the arts, and you mentioned script writing and plays. How has the Muslim community responded to that? Because maybe, just maybe, the overarching theme is like you have the big three, mashallah, doctor, engineer, lawyer, and if you're not part of that big three, God help you, you know. So how has the Muslim community responded? Do they appreciate this? Do they value this? Is it something that's marginalized? Is it something that's at the forefront? How has the Muslim community, in your experience, responded to My Voice and its endeavors and initiatives?
Because the product is a magazine and they don't see what happens in the back end, people think it's just the arts. It is a lot of it arts, but in the back end, the boys and girls are developing a lot of skills, entrepreneurial skills. App development is all technology, video editing, creation, graphic design, all of that is tech. So they are developing that and people don't realize that. The other thing is that in the beginning when we did start, they were apprehensive, and they did say that, what is this deal with pictures? Why do you need to have a photograph? Why do you need to have, why can't you just have hand-drawn flowers or something? So I did get a few of those, but if you know me, Muhammad, I don't really pay attention much to the community. I do have to it's been going really well. And I every year I say, wow, alhamdulillah, it's been a miracle this year too that we went through and we published. We used to distribute 20,000 magazines for free around the GTA in libraries, in mosques, at events and cafes, at schools, right? And 20,000 magazines, 24-page glossy, beautiful magazines cost a lot. it is a miracle, honestly. And I think with the arts, a lot of the parents have come to realize that what you put on your resume has to be diverse. You may be wanting to go into med school. It doesn't matter. But your med school teacher or interviewer is going to want to see how diverse, how many different types of experiences have you had? Have you worked at a Tim Hortons? Have you, you know, done like something creative? Have you raised funds for a cause? Just, we are actually right now running a winter drive for the neighborhood organization in Thorncliffe, where we're collecting either donations on our website or we are collecting things to give them. 19th of December is the last date. So these kids are not just doing it for themselves. We are trying to make them realize they need to raise funds for their, for other projects that in the community, you know, need funds. So alhamdulillah, they speak out on justice projects as well. The Uyghurs, the Rohingyas, when we had the Black Lives Matter, they did a lot of interviews of Black Muslims from the United States and Canada. So I would suggest people go to our YouTube channel and like it. And at the same time, watch these videos.
MashaAllah. And then on that note, you know, it's been a phenomenal conversation unpacking a lot of the amazing things and initiatives that our Muslim youth are spearheading, and not it's completely run by youth. You're MashaAllah, you're overseeing and making sure that, you know, not overstepping unnecessary boundaries, you know, and like, you know, getting people in hot water. But aside from that, it's youth run. It's made by the youth, for the youth, all for the youth, mashallah. And so with that, as you know, I'd be remiss to put a little bow tie in this conversation by asking if there was one piece of golden advice that you would give to our youth and to the parents, you know, the parents of the youth who may be watching this, you know, what would that be? And how can people reach out to My Voice and contact, you know, and get involved if they may, you know, whether they want to see more about the initiatives, be a part of it, participate, be a mentor, be a part of that team, what have you. So what's that piece of golden advice for the youth and the adults? And how can people find out more about My Voice?
To parents, I would just say that encourage your children to be a part of these organizations, whichever organization they want to be a part of, because they will need that, those skills. It builds their confidence, but at the same time, support them. So if they need to be driven somewhere, if they need to go somewhere, don't make a big deal. They're teenagers. They can't get there on their own. Help them that way. Secondly, with the youth, I would say I encourage you to apply. You would find your way, but be very committed and consistent. Thirdly, subscribe to our magazine. Our magazine is beautiful. When you get it, you would love reading it. It is an amazing collector's item, in my opinion. It is probably the best magazine you would have held and read in your life. I know I'm going on and on, but I actually love what these kids do. And our December issue, if you subscribe by Sunday on our website, you would be able to get a copy in the mail, inshallah. And please follow us on our social media. And if you're able to support our youth, there is a donation button on our website as well. Really appreciate it.
What's the website link? Just to make, is it My Voice Canada or what's the?
Yes, myvoicecanada.com.
My Voice Canada. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
Yes, myvoicecanada.com. And all of our social media icons are My Voice Canada, YouTube, as well as My Voice Canada.
So myvoicecanada.com, you're on that website, you get access to all the social media. Do Muslims have to be Canadian to benefit from this? Maybe someone who's watching from overseas is saying, hey, oh, it's only Canadians. What is it?
No, we actually have a lot of youth in New Jersey, like in the United States. And we had a few in the past from the UK as well, one or two from Malaysia. So, you know, whenever they find out, I've actually had requests from overseas, from different continents, asking how can we duplicate and replicate My Voice. So maybe if somebody has a business mind and can help us reach those places and duplicate this effort, that would be great.
There you go. So Masha, the origin story, the foundation is set in Canada, but this is worldwide for all Muslim youth. Inshallah. So My Voice. Oh, look at that. MyVoiceCanada.com. Look at that. So thank you so much, Sister Nargis, for turning our caterpillar youth into butterflies. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put more barakah in your initiative, helping the youth grow, find themselves, and be productive members of society that ultimately would make their parents smile all day long.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much, Muhammad.
You're most welcome. And tune in next week for another episode of Success Stories. This is your brother, Muhammad Maxwell Hassan here. Barakallahu feekum. Jazakumullahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum, asdiqai. Udtu ilaykum al-yawm wa ma'ya qissatun mushawwiqatun jadida. اسمها حلوى الكريمة، ولكن قصة اليوم تشبه الطقس عندنا. يا ترى ما دخل حلوى الكريمة بالطقس اليوم؟ تعالوا معا لنكتشف ما قصة يحيى مع حلوى الكريمة. هيا، هل أنتم متشوقون مثلي؟ قصتنا حلوى الكريمة. استيقظ يحيى ذات يوم وهو يشعر بالبرودة، كان الطقس باردا جدا. انظروا إلى يحيى، ما هذا؟ كل شيء حول بيتي مغطى باللون الأبيض. كما الشكل حول بيتي اليوم؟ كل شيء حول بيتي يحيى مغطى باللون الأبيض. قفز يحيى في سرور، انظروا إلى يحيى كم أنه متحمس. قفز يحيى في سرور، هلل وصاح، لقد صنعت لي أمي الكثير من الكريمة كما وعدتني. سمعت الأم صوت يحيى فدخلت إلى غرفته قائلة، صباح الخير يا يحيى. احتضن يحيى أمه بقوة وأخذ يردد، شكرا 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 يا ماما. لقد اندهشت الأم وسألته، لماذا تشكروني يا بني؟ قال، لأنك صنعت لي كل هذه الكريمة. كريمة؟ قالت ماما، عن أي شيء تتحدث يا يحيى؟ أنا لم أفهم. أخذ يحيى بيد أمه ثم انطلق وركض بها إلى النافذة. قال، تعالي انظري معي. انظروا، ها هو يحيى يطل من النافذة مع ماما. ضحكت الأم وقالت، حبيبي يحيى، أعلم أنه أول شتاء لك في هذا البلد. هذه ليست حلوى الكريمة يا بني، إنه الثلج. ظن يحيى أن هذا الثلج كله هو حلوى الكريمة. رد يحيى، ثلج؟ وما الثلج يا ماما؟ قالت الأم، عندما تنخفض درجة الحرارة يكون الجو باردا جدا، فإن بخار الماء المتجمع في السحب يتحول إلى ثلج بدلا من ماء المطر. انظروا إلى الثلج يهطل. لا لا يا أمي، هذه كريمة وسأثبت لك. انظروا إليه وهو متأكد من معلوماته. انظروا إلى يحيى. ثم جرى يحيى وأحضر ملعقة وطبقا صغيرا من المطبخ وركض خارج البيت ليملأ الطبق بالكريمة. انظروا، أخذ طبقا وانطلق خارجا ليأكل الكريمة. عاد يحيى إلى البيت وبعد دقائق بسيطة وجد الكثير من الماء يحيط بالكريمة في الطبق. انظروا، ماء في الطبق. أمي، ما هذا؟ ماذا حدث لحلوى الكريمة خاصتي؟ قالت ماما، حبيبي يا يحيى، لقد ذاب الثلج عندما تعرض للحرارة الدافئة داخل البيت وتحول إلى ماء مرة أخرى. قال يحيى، انظروا إلى يحيى. قال يحيى، لا 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 يا أمي لا، تعالي معي وسأثبت لك أن هذا حلوى الكريمة. لم يستسلم يحيى، أخذ يحيى بيد أمه وجرى خارج البيت. انظروا إلى يحيى، أخذ أمه معه هذه المرة ومعه الطبق والملعقة، ثم أخذ يأكل ويأكل بشراهة حتى امتلأ فمه بسرعة. ها هو يأكل. شعر يحيى بفمه يتجمد. It was freezing. قال في إحباط، نعم يا أمي أنت محقة، هذه ليست كريمة ضحكت ماما، انظروا. شعر يحيى بالحزن فقال لأمه: ألن يمكنني أبداً أن أجد كل ما حولي مغطاً بالكريمة مثل ما يغطي الثلج كل شيء هكذا؟ ردت الأم: بالتأكيد ممكن. وكيف يا أمي كيف؟ قالت الأم: انظر إليه وهو يجلس مع ماما. قالت الأم: في الجنة كل ما تتمنى يا يحيى. قال يحيى بتعجب: في الجنة كل ما أتمنى؟ قالت ماما: نعم يا صغيري، في الجنة كل ما تتمنى. حقا يا أمي؟ بيت من الحلوى والشوكولا، كثير من الألعاب، نهر من حليب الفراولة، وحصان يطير. انظروا إلى يحيى يحلم بأشيائه المحببة كلها. وحصان يطير، واو واو. ضحكت ماما وقالت: في الجنة يا يحيى كل ما تتمنى وأجمل مما تتخيل أيضا. انظروا إلى يحيى على حصان يطير، ها هو يجلس على الحصان. في الجنة كل ما أتمنى، ولكن كيف يا ماما؟ ردت الأم: قال رسولنا صلى الله عليه وسلم، هيا قولوا معي: صلى الله عليه وسلم، قال الله سبحانه وتعالى: أعددت لعبادي الصالحين ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. رواه البخاري. ردت معي يا صغيري: اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. هيا قولوا معي: اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة وكل ما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. على كل حال، اللعب بهذا الثلج ممتع جداً. أستطيع أن أتخيل نفسي الآن أسبح في طبق كبير من الكريمة. انظر إليه يستمتع باللعب بالثلج وهو يتخيل أنه يسبح بالكريمة. وأنتم، هل تحبون أن تلعبوا بالثلج مثله؟ وهل تخيلتم يوماً لو أن هذا الثلج كله كريمة؟ يا ترى لو كان كريمة، هل كانت ماما ستسمح لنا أن نلعب به؟ أظن أنه على حاله أفضل، ونستطيع أن نلعب به دون أن تتسخ ملابسنا. العبوا دائماً بالثلج وامرحوا، وتخيلوا ماذا تريدون أن تحصلوا بالجنة؟ على ما تريدون أن تحصلوا بالجنة؟ فكروا واحلموا وتمنوا واطلبوا من الله دائما أن يدخلنا وإياكم الجنة، وماما وبابا وكل أحبابنا إن شاء الله. هذه كانت قصتنا لليوم في برنامجكم قصصا للأطفال. كونوا معنا في كل يوم جمعة الساعة 8 مساء بتوقيت أونتاريو لنقرأ دائما القصص الجديدة. وإذا أعجبتكم القصة بإمكانكم الحصول عليها من مكتبة الياسمين. السلام عليكم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, welcome back to another session in which we are going to explore the different ways that we can try and understand the Quran, the very scripture Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us for our guidance. So today is going to be the third lesson, just a quick recap on the last two lessons. The first lesson we spoke about what our objective should be when we're approaching the Quran, and that should be that we are trying to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we want to try and attain the promises that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made for us, and try and build the best afterlife we can for ourselves. And when it comes to this Quran, all the ingredients to achieve that success is found within this very scripture. We also spoke about when it comes to the sources of trying to understand the Quran, There is no better person that can explain the Quran than our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because that was one of his mandates. And there's no one that understood it better than his loyal companions, his first students, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. And then you just continue with that chain with their students onwards. We also spoke about last week that when it comes to another component of the Quran, that is the Arabic language, we know that the Quran has been revealed in the Arabic language, and many of us who are non-Arabs are under the impression that if I know the Arabic language, then I will be able to understand the Quran. We demonstrated that that's not really true, that you will be able to understand certain components, but will we have a comprehensive understanding of the Quran? No. And we demonstrated that just by looking at two verses speaking apparently about the same thing, but giving us contradictory information. And we spoke about how it's important for us to have context. Also, when we are going to pursue the understanding of the Quran, it's important for us to identify at what level do we need to understand it at. That is very specific to a person, but you need to be very clear that I want to understand the Quran at this level or another level, whatever that level may be. And then you need to find the necessary education to accomplish that level. Now, Arabic is a very important component, but it's one of the many components that are there in order for us to get a clear picture as to what the Quran is talking about and what it's saying. I did also mention last week that when it comes to pursuing the higher studies of the Quran, the deeper meanings of the Quran and its interpretation, if there are people who are ready to put in that time and the work and the dedication behind this, and hopefully there is amongst our audience, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah makes you succeed in that endeavor, because we need more people. Remember, when it comes to the understanding of the Quran, it is no one's exclusive right. Okay, it's no one really has a complete, the word I want to use, basically no one's got complete control as to who's going to be authorized to understand the Quran and who is not. Any person, it doesn't matter which walk of life they may be from in the Ummah, they can put in the time, the dedication, build themselves and continue on the journey of getting a better understanding of the Quran as long as it takes. You know, it's not a matter of doing a few courses and now we've basically got this understanding. It's a matter of lifelong dedication to the scripture. And the more we invest our time and energy behind it, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up new doors of understanding and at the same time gives us a better comprehension of what the scripture is all about and how it could be useful to me and the ummah to better themselves. So on the note of intention, when we're making that intention that we want to go down this road, I wanted to quickly share a story that I did make an allusion to last week, but I didn't get a chance to get around to it. So today I'm going to talk about this little story, and then I want to talk about the next most important component, or a very important component, that we need to incorporate within our journey in order to understand the Quran. So the story is that when I was studying Sahih al-Bukhari with my teacher, who's just passed now, rahimahullah, we were going over the first hadith, Innam al-A'malu bin-Niyat, and in his lecture, he was telling us that when it comes to making intentions, it doesn't cost a nickel, a dime, or a penny to make grand intentions. And everything starts with an intention. So why don't you just go ahead and make the grandest of intentions that you can, and nothing should hold you back. At the end of the day, an intention is an intention, and hopefully that will materialize into something that is of substance and will turn into action. But action only comes after intention. So at that time, when I was listening to this lecture of my sheikh, I then made the intention, you know what, one day I want to write a English commentary on Sahih al-Bukhari, which did not exist at that time. And we're talking about over 20 years ago. Okay, there was an English translation that had come out, at that time was very recent. by Mohsen Khan, rahimahullah, who's passed on now. That translation just came out at that time, but there was no commentary as we have Fath al-Bari, Umdat al-Qari, Ibn al-Battal, and so forth. None of that existed. So I made the intention, I want to go ahead and make this contribution, and I want to write a book on fiqh, and I want to do a book on tafsir. I just made all of these intentions, right? And remember, it didn't cost me a dime or a penny, but subhanAllah, 20 years later now, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made those things a reality. And it only started with one intention during the class, right, that my sheikh was delivering. So I just wanted to share that with you only because that hopefully within this audience, there could be the next generation Mufassir. There could be the next generation Suyuti, the next generation Ibn Kathir, the next generation Qurtubi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what talent lies out there. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that when it comes to people, annasu ma'adin ka ma'adin al-dhahabi wal-fidda, that people are like the mines of gold and silver. Now, you and I know when it comes to mines of gold and silver, it's not like you just stroll into a mine and pick out all the gold you like. Mining is a complete process. Okay, first and foremost, locating, identifying, extracting, refining, and then after that, producing it into whatever item you want to make it into. You know, taking it from the ore, melting it, and doing whatever you want, whether you want to make biscuits out of it, whether you want to make plates out of it, whether you want to make jewelry out of it, you want to make ornaments, whatever it may be. But there's a process. So the Prophet ﷺ has made us very clear that all of us have got the gold and silver inside us, but we've got to make the effort to mine it out, refine it, and that takes time. But those people who go through that process, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show them success like He showed the people of our past. So with that being said, now moving on to the next component. One is the Arabic language, studying that at, you know, if we really want to get into understanding the Quran on an independent level and also appreciating that, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what I mean by appreciating it is like understanding that this cannot be written by man. There's a process that you have to go through, which I will very quickly go through, inshallah, and then talk about what I want to talk about today. Remember, as I spoke about this mildly last week, the Quran is at a different level of literature. This form of literature never existed before and nor has it existed afterwards. There is the concept of prose and the concept of poetry. Both have unique styles. Prose is complete sentences, one line, two lines, but a sentence. Okay, and then you have sentences composed in paragraphs. All right, when it comes to poetry, it's composed in couplets. And normally what you have is that the last portion of the couplet, it has a rhythm, it has a letter, it has a rhyme that's going to be consistent. Right, and then there, at the same time, there's messages that are being portrayed through metaphors in poetry. The more metaphorical you get, the more powerful you're going to be considered as a poet, right? And it's like it's allusion after allusion after allusion. So that pretty much is the style of poetry and prose. Now, when it comes to the Quran, it didn't fit the style of poetry. It didn't fit the style of prose. It was this unique hybrid, which at the end was so beautiful. It's a new genre altogether. But you can only recognize that once you've studied prose properly, you've studied poetry properly, and then you look at the Quran and say, well, Allahu Akbar, this is just at another level. There is no way a person with no literacy skills at all can come up with a brand new genre altogether and render everyone speechless, because it's beautiful, it makes sense, it's well composed. Anyone that listens to it, that knows poetry and prose, is mesmerized by it. It's just at another level. And just by studying a bit of grammar and a bit of morphology, you're not going to be able to see that for what it is. So this is why I'm encouraging you, go the full 9 yards. It's going to take a bit of time, but wallahi al-azim, it's well worth the journey. Now, the other component that is required in order for us to understand the Quran is to study the biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember, the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is linked with the Quran. We know that the Quran was revealed in a span of 23 years, right? The Prophet ﷺ got his first revelation at the age of 40. Then there's going to be a three-year pause in the revelation. And then after the revelation is going to resume all the way to prior to the Prophet ﷺ's passing. So it came in installments. And those installments were addressing something that was going on in the time of Rasulullah ﷺ. Whether it's going to be consolation, whether it's going to be guidance, whether it's going to be direction, whether it's going to be teachings for that particular time and incident. It's basically now guiding the Prophet ﷺ and the rest of the Ummah what to do in particular situations. But in order for us to understand what that situation was, if we simply go back and look at the related ahadith, remember the ahadith, they're just anecdotes. Right? They're not giving you the full picture. They're just anecdotes. A person, a reporter is going to be telling you that the Prophet ﷺ was doing this at the time or said that at the time. It's going to be very limited information. Okay? And it's not going to give you a clear picture. And I'll tell you, like, me myself, when I started the Quran, when I started studying it, and I did study the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ many years before that, but it was very rusty. Okay, we just studied one book and that was pretty much it. Now, it was my responsibility to go and refresh on that. Now, when we're starting to study, when we're starting to study the tafsir, and that was a three-year, actually a four-year program. Okay, we had a four-year program just studying the tafsir from cover to cover. So in that journey, you're going to come across incidents such as Badr, Tabuk, Uhud, or incidents related to the Prophet ﷺ's attempted assassination and so forth. And if you don't know the chronology of that, it's not going to really make sense. Everything is so abstract. Or for example, Allah says, وَيَوْمَ الْحُنَيْنِ إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ فَلَمْ تُغْنِ عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ. Allah's talking about the day of Hunayn. Okay, and this is intermingled with the conversation on Tabuk. So this is in Surah At-Tawbah. So Allah subhanahu is talking about Hunayn. And recall the time when your numbers had pleased you, had amazed you. أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ. Right? فَلَمْ تُغْنِي عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا. And that did not avail you in any shape or form. So now I'm looking at, okay, Hunayn. When was Hunayn? Okay, so if I didn't refresh on the Prophet ﷺ seerah, I have no idea what Allah's talking about here. What is Hunayn? What was the day of Hunayn? Was it a festival? Was it a holiday? What was the day of Hunayn? And what was really going on due to which that these Sahaba felt that we're so big right now and فَلَمْ تُغْنِي عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا. This thought process did not benefit them in any shape or form. Well, how did it not benefit them? So if I don't have the complete story in front of me, I don't have the chronology of events in front of me, the Quran is not going to make sense. This is why I tell all of my students at the Mathaba Institute, what we teach all of our students is a entry-level program in which they have to know their belief system, the essential rituals, and at the same time, the complete biography of the Prophet. Also, we spend a lot of time on that, taking them through the journey, through graphs, charts, pictures, because I've been to all those places, I would take pictures, I post, okay, this is where this happened, this is where that happened, so you have a visual. And then especially when you're actually there at the place and you can connect, everything makes sense, what Allah's talking about. Okay, he's talking about this place, he's talking about that place. You have this physical connection with it. And then that makes everything about the Quran then falls in place. So I will at least ask all of us that are viewing here, that pick up a book on the comprehensive biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where you can go through the chronology of events. And then when you look at the Quran, you'll be able to understand, okay, Allah's talking about this incident, and this is the complete picture of what happened at that time. And these are the lessons Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us in respect to this particular incident. Now, whether that's going to be Badr, like you see in Surah Ali Imran, you see references of Uhud there, and you're going to see, for example, the assassination plot of the Prophet ﷺ in Surah Al-Anfal. You're going to see Tabuk and Hunayn spoken about in Surah At-Tawbah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is revealing the different stories of the messengers, why is he doing that? Why is he really telling us about, or why is he revealing Surah Hud, Surah Yunus, Surah Yusuf, Why is he revealing that? What was going on at the time of the Prophet or during his life at that time? And when you understand that the Prophet was going through depression, the Prophet at that time was facing challenges where now he's being outcasted. He's not even welcome in his own home because everything started falling apart upon the passing of Abu Talib, which happened in the 10th year of the Prophet's mission after they have just been released from the three-year embargo. So all of these surahs are being revealed for a particular reason, a purpose. If you don't have that picture in front of you, it's all going to be abstract. So this is the final message I'm going to give, inshallah, for today's lesson. Number one, make grand intentions. You know, try and go down the full nine yards when it comes to studying the Arabic language. You become proficient in prose and composition, understanding composition, deciphering, and so forth. You understand poetry, and it's going to take many years, but wallahi al-azim, it's well worth the journey. And you start studying the detailed biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then when you look at the Quran, it's just another experience altogether. Hopefully, inshallah, this has been a benefit to all our viewers. Inshallah, I will talk about the third component next week. But until then, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He blesses you all and your families. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.